What's going on, everybody? This is Powerhouse Radio. It's your boy DJ Prosper here.
And it's your girl Ray.
And we are mobile today. We are live and direct in Nashville, Tennessee.
That's right.
And we have a special guest that we're so honored to have today. She's an artist and a worship leader from Miami, Florida. We know that she's mentored by Pastor John P. Key. She's served at many churches such as House of Hope in Atlanta, Potter House in Dallas, and now she resides here in Nashville, Tennessee. Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, Canada, we have Sister Maranda Curtis. Mm-hmm. How you doing?
I am wonderful. I'm wonderful.
Oh, thank you so much for coming here and, you know, accepting our invitation. You're looking great.
Thank you so much.
So it says that you reside here in Nashville. So we were talking off camera about
See,
the fact that you moved
I wasn't telling
here.
The world what I was doing. I was going to kind of let them figure it out. But hey, I'm here in Nashville.
Wow.
Yeah.
And why Nashville out of all?
Well, outskirts of Nashville, really.
Okay.
Cause I like it because it's peaceful here.
Okay.
You know, when you live a life on... In airports and on planes, okay. You want to retreat somewhere where it's just calm.
Okay.
And so this represents the calm for me. Yeah.
Okay. Because it's our first time here.
Really?
Right? We never came to Nashville. We drove 15 hours.
Part
to
of
be
the
here.
Traffic here.
Right.
It's growing.
Right. And it's very similar, actually, to Ottawa. But
Definitely.
We know that Nashville, you know, we know that it's the capital city of country music.
Yeah.
And music we know that city. It's big in CCM as well.
Yeah.
But how's the gospel community here?
Well, I'm still trying to figure that out. Like I said, you know, because I'm new here
okay.
and I'm still getting to know people
okay.
Here. And it is a musical city.
Right.
Full circle here. You mm-hmm. find it all
okay.
right here in the city of Nashville.
Okay.
Yeah.
Nice. And it's calm and it's.
For me, it is.
That's good.
Yeah, so I just wanted to say, first of all, you look beautiful.
Thank
and
you.
I know there's been a big transition for you health-wise. I was listening to Open Heaven, and there was a beautiful testimony in there mm-hmm. about the changes you had with health. Talk to us about that and that process of basically coming into your wellness.
Oh, wow. 2016, December 2016, the day after Christmas. Mm-hmm. I had been feeling sick the entire month, but being hard-headed, didn't mm-hmm. want to go to the doctor. Oh, it's the flu. I'll get over it. Mm-hmm. 2 weeks later, I'm like, wait a minute. Something's wrong. Mm-hmm. And so I woke up that morning, the day after Christmas, because I had lost a lot of weight. Mm-hmm. And I said, this isn't normal. But I woke up that morning, and I literally said, I'm dying. Mm-hmm. I've never uttered those words in life. I went to the emergency room, told them my symptoms, and they said, we'll test you for the flu. Came back, they said, ma'am, you don't have the flu, so we're going to draw some blood and see what's going on with you. And the doctor came back and said, type 2 diabetes. I said, whoa, my dad is type 2 diabetes. He has it. And he was diagnosed, I was 37 at the time. My dad was 38 when he got diagnosed. And it just shook me. And they kept me for a few days. And in that hospital, because I'd never been hospitalized before, I said, no, I'm going to change the way I eat and change the way I do things. And left out of there. And I said, all right, I'm going to give myself a realistic time because you have, you know, unhealthy habits and whatnot. And I'm going to lose this weight. I'm going to get off of this insulin. Who likes needles? I don't. And it took less than a year to do, actually 11 months
wow.
to get off of insulin. Mm. And that's just been my journey ever since. I gained because I got comfortable again, but I end up losing again too. Mm. So I'm on my way to my goal, yes. praise the Lord.
Right.
But it's important especially when we do what we do for the kingdom of God, sometimes we forget that our bodies is really the temple of the Holy Spirit, and that these are things that we have to take care of. We can't travel the world and be unhealthy. Mm-hmm. So it's a very serious matter to me that even on the road,
yes.
you choose your snacks wisely. But yeah.
Definitely. I think that's something we're even learning too.
So it's easy to gain weight on the road.
So easy. So we're going to talk about responsible worship in a little bit.
Okay.
But I recently watched an interview that you did, and you actually mentioned your parents were R&B singers. So talk to us about that journey into coming into ministry and coming into Christ.
Ooh, my parents, I call them rebellious. Because they grew up in church. Okay. They grew up in church, and they did. I laughed about it. And they didn't take us to church. Great parents, but Sundays, we were at home chilling. Mm. Or we would go to the beach or something like that. And it was a very musical house. They did travel. They did sing R&B. I did sit in their rehearsals and, and watch them. Mm. And they're very gifted people. Mm. It wasn't until we moved from Miami when I was 12 years old to Georgia, where my dad is from. Mm-hmm. Wanted to slow the pace down. And it was a culture shock, but it was good for us. And I met my grandfather, his dad, who I found out was a pastor. Mm-hmm. He still is to this day. He's 85. Okay. And I said, we have a pastor in the family? And out of obedience, I would go to church. Out of obedience, get in the choir. Okay, I got in the choir. I still didn't let God into my heart. I was just being obedient to my parents. And this went on for years until I turned 19 years old. Hmm. 19 years old, I said, okay, something is changing. Something is happening. 20 got here, and I gave my heart to the Lord. Okay, so I just turned 40 in August. So 20 years in, you know, thank you, Jesus. And I gave my heart to the Lord, and I said, it's time that I start to know the Jesus that I've been singing about.
Right.
Now, prior to me giving my heart to the Lord, I was still anointed. Mm. The Spirit of the Lord still moved. Right. You know, I just didn't identify what it was. Okay. But that transformation, it's different when you sing with knowledge and you sing with understanding. The Bible speaks of that. So 20 years in this, leading worship at the age of 20, trial and error. Still trial and error, but it was something I was pushed into. You can sing, so lead worship.
Right. And there's so many people that have that same story. So what was like the intention between that switch, just singing and leading praise and worship, and then actually having that meaning behind it? What was that intention that made you make that switch?
What made me make that switch was just visiting other ministries, because it wasn't until then that I realized that I was in a box. I was like, whoa, so it's bigger than where I go to church at. Ooh, and it was traditional and good Baptist church. And the conviction that came upon me when I was introduced to another way of life, introduced to another way of living, it was the conviction that caused the switch.
Okay.
And I was like, oh, there's a void in my life.
Okay.
I want to fill it with Jesus.
So how did you transition to Dallas after that?
Oh, Lord, that's a journey.
From Georgia. Okay.
No, I was 22 years old when I met Pastor John Peakey.
Right.
He would have every summer this VIP conference. I don't know if you all ever heard about it, but some of his albums, if you pay attention, it would be John Peakey and the VIP.
Yes.
Right.
It came from that conference.
Okay.
And so he would have a VIP conference and a showcase.
Okay.
My choir went. I led the last song. And he didn't say, hey, the choir sounds good. He didn't say nothing. He said, who are you? And he singled me out. And every year we would still come. And then when I turned 26, I got a phone call from him. Don't know how he got my number to this day.
Wow.
I need a worship leader. If you want the job, it's yours. I was like, job? I didn't know worship leaders got paid because I served. I served, and I went to Charlotte first with Pastor Key.
Okay.
And I was there as worship leader for 5 years, and I traveled with him as well.
Okay.
Then I moved back home to Atlanta.
Oh, wow.
I was hiding out. Pastor E. Dewey Smith saw me and was like, hey, come work at my church. I said, no, it's too big. And and that's how House of Hope happened.
Yeah.
I served there for nearly 7 years, but the Lord started opening doors. Mm-hmm. Yes. And so I wasn't there as much.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about that a little bit. Though, because at that church, I remember watching that viral video on YouTube. Yep, nobody like you, Lord. And when, I remember when I saw that, it was like nothing we had ever seen. Right. It was like you have the CCM kind of worship and praise. It was like you were the first person I didn't see in a box.
Mm. Wow.
And it was 5.4 million views. So talk to us about the moment of that switch and then how it impacted you overall, because you're serving here and now you're getting all of these requests.
Definitely, because I remember too where Ooh. I was when I saw that video for the first time.
I haven't seen that video in years, actually, because I think God is strategic. Mm. And I remember that day, and I know why I blocked it out years ago, because at the time it reminded me of one of the worst times of my life. Mm. And what people don't know is that viral video, I was kicking and screaming on the inside saying, Lord, just let me cry, let me scream. I don't want to minister to thousands of people today. Mm. Because at the time I was married, going through separation and divorce. Oh, wow. And my world was crumbling. Mm. I don't want to. And so at that time I'm singing, fill me up. It wasn't for people, it was for me. Mm. So I was singing from a different place. Okay. That was personal. Right. And to see that go viral, I'm like, God, why would you remind me of this pain? Why would you do that? But he was strategic, and that opened doors. For me.
I think it opened door because it related to a lot of people's situation as well. Going through similar pain.
Yeah.
Not necessarily the same situation, but the pain, the struggle.
Indeed.
Right?
So, indeed. And so that opened up so many doors. Mm. And I'm like, whoa. Wow. So it exceeded. I didn't have an expectation because I was just being obedient and I was serving and people were blessed by it.
Wow. And that's something that is so crucial. Mm-hmm. Even in these moments, I just want to ask you, we're here with Maranda Curtis, if you're just tuning in now, but if you had a word of inspiration for an upcoming artist who is seeing that basically your struggle is leading to your testimony that you're writing in your songs, like what is some encouragement that you would give them as they're opening up and they're writing these songs that are actually ministering to them as well?
To continue on that path, it's a dangerous thing to go along with a wave. It's a dangerous thing to do. That testimony, that sound, whatever God has revealed, release it. Because you're overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the words of your testimony. Now, however, humility is attached to what we do. Humility will get you into doors that sometimes your anointing won't.
Ooh, that's good.
Because you can be anointed, but still your character not line up. Mm. It can happen because God can use anyone.
Sure.
And so sometimes, you know, humility is attached to what we do. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in his holy place? Mm-hmm. He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who have not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. You can't worship and be vain at the same time.
Let's go.
And so remember, when you humble yourself, the Lord will exalt you. And the sound that he has housed in you and that he has placed in you was not a mistake.
That's good.
Yeah.
So now you're praising worship.
Uh-huh.
You're working for Bishop T.D. Jakes, Potter's House. And then there's a viral song going on, right? Nobody Like You, Lord.
Yeah.
So how did you make that transition from just being a praise and worship leader to singing professionally? And how did that come about? Like, you know, to answering the call of going to record a song, being in the studio, and just doing this as artistry now.
One, I wasn't looking for it. Mm. I wasn't trying. I did it once before, and I was like, I won't do that again. Mm. And when Nobody Like You, Lord was birthed, it was during praise and worship. It wasn't something I sat down and wrote it.
Okay.
It was actually birthed during praise and worship. And my friend said, record that.
Okay.
And I said, okay, I'll give it a try. I went to record it. But before I released it on iTunes and all of that, I actually gave my song away. I gifted my song to churches and said, hey, just sing my song in your churches. So I gave it to over 100 churches.
Wow.
before I even released it.
Okay. So
I sold a seed.
So churches were singing in the praise and worship services.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. And I said, because I didn't, at the time, I didn't want monetary gain out of it. I was just saying, here, get it. But now I'm reaping the harvest of what I've sown. Mm. So it wasn't my motive in the beginning to, hey, I'm going to be a gospel artist. And I'm going to be, no, it was a song of the, it was a song of my heart that I sung to the Lord. Mm-hmm. And he responded to it. And here, just take it and sing it in your church. Mm.
So how did it grow now to being in the gospel industry?
Oh,
right? So now you're leading praise and worship at church and all, but we know that there's a difference between, you know, just being a worshiper at church and now being in the gospel industry aspect of things.
That's so touchy for me because because you touched on it earlier that when you saw me in the past, that you saw that I wasn't in a box. Mm. That's something I refuse to be in, period. Mm-hmm. Because I refuse to lose my authentic self based on what a man says I should be doing. Mm. Now, there's some wisdoms that I've collected from people because I can't do this thing on my own. Yeah. I said, God, I won't sign to a record label unless it makes sense. Mm-hmm. If I'm going to sign my life away, you know, and so there are things that God, that's my word. He's strategic and he set these things up to where not only can I be heard in the continental, you know, United States, that I'm all over the world now. Mm-hmm. And it's humbling that he sent people my way to say, hey, we don't want anything from you. Mm-hmm. We see what you have and we just want to help spread this all over the world. Mm-hmm. And so the gospel industry thing, it has its, you know, I just believe Jesus is the star.
Well, let's keep it real. We know that it's still a music business, right?
What I'm saying is the humbling piece of it. And so you can still be in it and not of it. Mm. And so I'm not driven, but I think I've met everybody I wanted to meet, honestly.
Right.
And so there's the business side. Mm-hmm. And then there's the churchy side.
Right.
I say, I've had enough of the churchy side. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to understand the industry that I'm in and out of. Mm. And so with that being said, there's a wisdom to it. You know, it's a great thing. And everybody's not horrible. Everybody's not bad. Okay. I've met some incredible people. Like I said, I've learned to surround myself with people who are where I want to be.
Okay.
Because if you're the smartest one in your circle, something's wrong.
Yes.
And so I've learned to place myself around amazing people, knowledgeable people. Mm-hmm. That so when people say the industry thing, I'm like, it don't affect me that much because I'm in it, but I'm not of it.
Right.
You know, it didn't house my sound. It didn't whatever. So every door, there's still a spiritual thing attached to it because God still opened the door. It's still supernatural. Mm-hmm. Everything that I do and everything that I'm known for, it will remain. Because it was the name that got me here, Jesus. Mm-hmm. It was the name that got me here. And so if it got me here, the way I was raised, that's what you stick to.
Right. Mm.
And so, yeah. And so from
you just
that,
be planted you just and stay got strong to
yeah, who you are. And stay true to who you are. Because if you enter into this and not know who you are,
it's over. It's over.
It is over. Mm-hmm. I've always had colored hair. Something just happened.
So unique.
I've had it low. I've had it low. Mm-hmm. I've had it gray like this. It's back gray, pink, and purple, and green because I like color.
Yes.
You know, and that's just a part of who I am and what I like to do. I like frames and glasses. Mm, I like those things. I like quirky little things. Mm. And I don't apologize for
that's
it.
Right.
And it has never stopped me from getting invitations to minister to people.
That's
because
cool.
I'm so glad that people, thank you, Jesus, they're able to see past this and see who's in me. And so it is important that not only that I'm knowledgeable of the industry that I'm in and out of, but maintain my Holy Ghost. Mm. You know, it is important that you don't lose that aspect.
I could so relate to what you're saying. Because I grew up as a Seventh-day Adventist family. Right? Very strict and whatnot. Yeah. And for some reason, as I grew up, I was always out the box. So I always wanted my, and I'm from like a Haitian background. So
I think we're cousins.
So I grew up with, you know, I wanted, I had the box haircut, the Bobby Brown, you know,
the gummy
and all that. And I was like the only one at my church, and people would criticize me and saying, yo, da 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 da. And I always grew up that way. And 6 years ago, I decided to grow the dreads. So I had dreads and everything. And people were telling me that, you know, church folks would never accept you that way, and so on and so on. But I always stuck true to who I was, right? And exactly, I never experienced anything that like that, like churches neglecting me because of how I looked and whatnot. So like you said, it's very important to know who you are.
But isn't there a freedom in that, though, a liberty in that, knowing who you are and loving who God created you to be? Like, that's a liberty in that. And it starts to show, you know? My mom was quirky like that.
Nice.
She passed away in March of this year. And I look just like her. But, you know, she was the same way. She was the only person I know would walk around with cowboy boots year round. And she was just that kind of person. And if I didn't learn anything else, she taught me to, you're fearfully and wonderfully made. You're beautiful, even down to the gap in your mouth, your gap teeth, your big eyes, and you're beautiful just the way you are.
That's right.
And don't ever question it.
That's right.
And I took that and I said, okay, this is who I am. And she embraced her features, her high cheekbones like I got, and her big eyes. And, you know, she embraced it. I said, I ain't closing my gap.
Nice.
It's gonna stay.
So just one question about the gospel industry.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask, because, you know, in the secular, there's this trend of now promoting the fact that, you know, you don't need a record label. You need to be independent. Now, being an independent artist is in now. But in the gospel world, how is that? You know, what would you say about that?
Oh,
would it be preferably to be independent or to be signed to a label still?
I wouldn't say either or. I just think whatever works for you works for you. I know a lot of people that have thrived off of, you know, being signed to a label. Me, on the other hand, it was my independence that got the attention of labels. Because when I released my EP, it was independent.
Right.
And it shot to number one on Billboard by myself.
Right. Okay.
And so it was like, record label's like, who is this person? Let's talk to her.
Right.
You know, and all of that stuff. So am I attached to a label? Yes. I'm still considered an independent artist because it's just, you know, the distribution piece.
Right.
But every project that you all have seen from me, I funded.
Nice. Okay.
And I'm about to fund another one. And I love the liberty in that.
Okay.
So I'll say, you know, whatever works for you, works for you. And I've seen people sign, and it's a success. So whatever works for you, works for you. I love my setup.
That's good.
It may change, but I love it for now.
That's good.
Yeah.
Okay.
Definitely. You touched on something a little bit earlier. If you're just tuning in here, we are talking with none other than Maranda Curtis here on Powerhouse Radio. And one of the things that you said was that you've had this authenticity about you always throughout your career. And we saw that in Open Heaven, an amazing, amazing album. And you can see that that authenticity is what got you nominated for these Stellars and these wins, and you're performing at the Dove Awards and all of these things. What is that process and experience like as you're moving through your career and getting more accolades and more recognition?
Okay. So, no, I'm a country girl, and I take it all in, and I'm grateful, and it makes me appreciate the hard work that I put in. It's like when you do things for yourself with the help of the Lord, but when you do things and you have the work ethic and you stand back and say, wow, I really worked hard. You know, you can appreciate it more. I appreciate the grind. I appreciate all of those things. And so now I forget that people kind of know me. And so I'll travel by myself and like around the city, Maranda Curtis. And then sometimes it'll dawn on me, oh yeah, my bad. Hey y'all, and you don't have security?
That's me.
Seriously.
I just go and eat and go home. But, you know, it's humbling.
Yes.
It is really humbling because you could be here today and gone tomorrow.
That's right.
And that's why attitude matters. Mm. Your temper matters. And it's just nice to be nice to people.
Right.
That's what I've learned. But this the stellar nominations, that blew me away. Mm-hmm. I think it's just hitting me that it was 7 nominations. Yeah. My first full album.
Right.
And a performance on the show. That's unheard of.
Yes.
The Doves, I presented and sung at the pre-show. I was like, me?
Mm-hmm.
It was so humbling.
Mm-hmm.
It was so great.
Mm-hmm.
And I took it all in
mm-hmm.
and just enjoyed the experience
mm-hmm.
and that people thought enough of me
mm-hmm.
to say, hey, we mm-hmm. want her to come and be a part.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And now you're like amongst the elite of women in gospel.
Wait, what?
Yeah, because
yes,
we were at the Essence Festival in New Orleans, and we saw you as well on the Sunday. With
all that
you
yellow
were with Mary, Keisha, Career Shear, and Tasha Cobbs, and
yeah.
we saw you up over
those
there.
Those amazing women.
So you're now like we don't hear, you know, if we hear women of gospel now, Maranda Curtis is among the list, right?
Really?
So.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm really serious right now. Really?
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Whoa. I love how humble she is right now.
I'm about to tear up because I wasn't looking for this.
And I think that is so beautiful.
And you're my nephew's go-to.
Yes.
I mean, when we speak about, remember Sunday, we were talking, you know, we have Sunday dinners with family and everything. And I have a nephew that is like, she's my go-to.
Yes.
I don't even know who she is, but she's my go-to and he's on YouTube. Right. And
wow,
that's what it is right
this
now.
This is humbling, y'all. For whatever reason God chose me, I'm grateful.
But you saw the reception in Toronto when you went to Toronto.
Can I say something about that?
Mm-hmm.
I had never been, what they call it, the headliner of a concert or whatever.
Yeah, okay.
And walk in a church that beautiful.
Mm.
I didn't know until I walked out there.
Mm.
That place was packed to capacity.
Okay.
I had to turn around for a moment because I was like, Jesus, whoa.
Mm.
And I was actually overwhelmed
mm-hmm.
because I didn't know that people, I never go places thinking people are supposed to know who I am because I'm on this flyer.
Mm.
But I was actually blown completely away.
Mm.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to segue to that because now you're bringing a whole worship experience into Canada,
mm-hmm.
right? How
about
you talk to us a little bit more about the clinic and the live recording that's going to happen next year, 2020?
Mm-hmm. The Responsible Worship Clinic.
Let's go.
Toronto. I'm so geeked about that. 2020, March 12th through 14th.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to register, I would love for you to register. Go to my website, imaranda.com. Now, that's Maranda with an A, though. M-A-R-A-N-D-A.
Mm-hmm.
We have amazing clinicians coming to teach. We have amazing worship leaders coming. And then we're going to end it all with a live recording.
Mm-hmm.
And that was something that I wasn't planning at first.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord laid it on my heart to do that. It's time.
Hmm.
It's time. I said, okay, God, it's time, because the season that he has me in and the songs that I've been writing lately, it's a bit more intense than Open Heaven.
Mm.
Yeah. Okay. I won't say a bit more. It is more.
Right.
Intense, because life has happened since then, and especially with the death of my mother.
Yeah.
God has me in an amazing space and of quietness and all of that. So this live recording, if you have registered VIP, don't worry. You get in for free.
Mm-hmm.
If you have not registered VIP, the admission is $25.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope to see y'all there.
Oh, we're there. It's not even a question.
Give y'all a press pass.
Oh, yeah.
Definitely. So what birthed Responsible Worship?
I went to Johannesburg, South Africa, in 2015.
Mm-hmm.
I went there celebrating my birthday, and I had to do a workshop and also sing at a concert this church was having. And I saw their response to God. Mm. I saw how the worship leaders got up, and it was a custom of the house. It was just, whoa. They didn't get up and say, lift your hands and do all of this. It was known that when they get up, this is what it's time for, worship. And not once did they say or coerce the people to say, hey, let's do this, jump up and down and do it. No, the worship leader got up and the people went into worship. So much so that there was no preach word that night. It was supposed to have been a preach word. It never happened. We stayed in worship for 3.5 hours straight. Wow. And didn't come out. Mm-hmm. The reason it stopped was because we had to come back Sunday.
That's amazing.
And in that time of worship, I was convicted. Amen. And I repented. Mm-hmm. And I told the Lord that I was sorry for what I thought worship was and my response to him and not giving him my best. There was a conviction that came over me. And I said, when I go back to the States, I'm going to see to it that I share this experience and that we become more responsible with the mantle that you've given us, the calling that you've given us, the responsibility that you've given us. It's important that we handle that with care. We can't just be worship leaders and just be all around. And you know, worship teams now can be a little cliquish, you know.
Talk about it.
And I'm like, wait, where's the glory in that? How does God get the glory? So it was birthed from that experience and the conviction to be more responsible for how I handle the things of God.
And even in that process, I saw some clips of last year, and that was phenomenal. What were some of the takeaways that you guys, that you even had personally last year after you did that conference?
Oh, my goodness. It definitely stirred up the leader in me as well. I'm a nurturer. I don't have any physical children, but I felt like a mother. I felt like a nurturer. I felt I gained some children that night spiritually, that during that time. And the liberty that was in that room the entire time, it was like people were relieved. And I think they may have gone home and got frustrated because of the peace and the liberty that they had. But the word, we walked away with a declaration as well. And I posted the declaration, and we're going to stand by it. And to be responsible for what we, for what we've done. And also I use responsible worship to bring my mentees in and let them work. So a lot of times when you see my flyers with responsible, you may not see a lot of faces that you know. It's not about that for me. It's about making sure that the generation behind me, and I wish I had that. I wish I had somebody to say, sit down. I wish I had somebody to tell me, no, go pray about it. You know, you're not ready. I wish I had someone to tell me that. And so now God has enabled me to do this for this generation coming up. And so when they come to responsible worship, they come to serve. They serve. They lead worship. They serve. It's humbling just to let you know that even when God elevates you, don't get so above yourself. When you humble yourself, he still does the exalting.
This is awesome, because I saw the flyer as well, and I saw the lineup of all these worship leaders from all around the world.
Yes!
I'm talking about London, Nigeria, and so on,
I mentor half of them.
Oh, okay. Talk to me about that list. Like, they're all coming to Toronto?
They're all coming to Toronto.
What?
They're all coming. Okay. So, I'm a fan. First of all, I glean from Dr. Judy McAllister. She's just... She was my blueprint for praise and worship. And then you have Nathaniel Bassey. I don't know if I'm going to be able to take that. I just don't know. I said, Miranda, what are you doing? What are you doing? But it's the glory of God. Juanita Francis.
Right.
I mentor her.
Okay.
For the last 5 years, oh, nice. Actually. And then we have a native, actually, Jennifer
Lewin.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. I experienced her. No, but here's the thing about her. I saw a clip of her singing Open Heaven. Mm. And I said, wait a minute. You blessed me with my own song.
Oosh.
I need you there.
Wow.
I need you there. You have so many other people. Deborah Haynes, Carolina, she is the brains behind. If you heard the James Fortune song, I Am.
Yes.
She co-wrote that song.
Wow.
And she's an amazing, young, anointed, and I'm talking about young people with substance. Mm-hmm. And so you're gonna be blessed. Mm-hmm. Tim Reddick, you're just gonna be blessed by these young people.
Oh, this is exciting.
All of them in their 20s.
Canada, Toronto, wherever you are, Ottawa, Montreal,
they need
to show up. Winnipeg, they need to make that.
Make the drive.
What?
Wait,
Toronto
how far
is
that?
The spot. Well, Winnipeg. It's a flight.
Oh, and I have to say, Phil Thompson will be there.
Oh, yes.
Right. Let's go.
My worship. Oh my God. Just, ooh.
Oh, we're definitely going to promote that.
I think we're setting ourselves up.
Oh, yeah. Ottawa's going to be there. And for sure, Montreal needs to head up there as well, right?
Wow.
Now, you were saying, right, the Responsible Worship album is a little bit more intense. Life happened, right?
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of different situation. Now, you know, a lot of people don't understand that. Yes, you're an artist to people. And you do music and so on, but you go through stuff, right? And even as servant of the Lord, we go through stuff.
Yeah.
We deal with a lot of mental challenges.
Yes.
You know, what was your go-to, or what is your go-to? How do you go through these pains when you go to bed at night by yourself?
Yeah.
You know, you feel discouraged at times.
Yeah.
You know,
I still process that. Mm-hmm. Losing my mother this year in March was the greatest pain that I've ever experienced. I had a moment this week at the Doves. My dad came and she wasn't here. You know, when she passed away, the following week I was at the Stella Awards.
Hmm. Wow.
And I made my dad come because I said, I can't do this by myself.
Hmm.
And I've learned to, what helps me is allowing myself to feel and tuning out the voices telling you, well, you know, because some people, I don't know if they think about what they say sometimes because it's your mother. Mm-hmm. She brought me in this earth, you know. And no one nowhere can tell you how long.
Yes.
Mm. It's been 7 months.
Mm-hmm.
Today is what? The 18th?
March 18th. Yeah.
The 19th tomorrow will be 7 months.
Mm.
And so anything can trigger it. I didn't grieve her immediately. I grieved her in June in the middle of a photo shoot.
Wow.
Hmm.
I grieved her. Wasn't thinking about it. I was just snapping these pictures in the middle of Death Valley, a desert in California.
Wow.
And I'm in Death Valley. Ain't that something?
Hmm.
And it wasn't until then that I found out that I was existing. I stood there and felt the wind of God wrap himself around me. And I did this and the floodgates were open. I cried, ruined all my makeup, ruined everything, and I began to breathe. And it wasn't, I realized I had been walking around here holding my breath in.
Mm.
And I said to God, this hurts. I know you have her. I know she's healed on that side.
Mm-hmm.
But I miss her.
Mm-hmm.
I never thought this would happen.
Mm-hmm.
I can never say I was angry with God.
Okay.
I can never say that because that was not what I felt.
Okay.
I just expected her to come back and just, she's a fighter. She's strong and she'll beat it.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't happen this time.
Mm-hmm.
And on her deathbed, I held her hand and I sung Open Heaven to her. And I stopped and I said, she's not coming back, is she, God? He said, no. And I said, I don't want to release her. He said, well, there's hope in the room. And when there's hope in the room, she's going to remain. But as soon as hope leaves, I need y'all to let her go. Hmm. And it was the hardest thing to do. But out of that came so many songs. I said, I now understand what it's really like to be in a dark place and be brought back into the light. I know what it's like now to literally be the walking dead and come back to life. And it's amazing that I found life in a place called Death Valley.
Wow. Mercy.
So he used it. And ever since then, I've been in this space of Lazarus, studying his story, because it was very peculiar because he stayed dead the longest. Till he started to stink. And God called him back. Jesus called him back, called him, called his name, Lazarus, come forth. He came forth. He was alive and well. But it wasn't enough for Lazarus to just be alive. In order for Lazarus to have an abundant life, the grave clothes had to come off. He wouldn't have had a productive life just being alive.
That's right.
With grave clothes on. And so I know what it's like to shed that. So now I'm writing from a different place.
Wow.
Because life happened.
Wow.
And it's okay because it's been therapeutic. So my go-to, I write. I pray and I write. My devotional life is more intense than it has ever been. I've been in my word now. I love the word, but it's been more intense. And so I'm always the person to say, sing with understanding. And so the revelation that God has been giving me, that's where it's been. So you all will hear a lot of that. It's not sad, but it will, I believe with my whole heart that it will cause a revival. Because the only way something can be revived, it has to be dead.
That's cool.
And so it'll bring it back to life. And so now I can sing from that place because I know what that was like.
So how did you came about with the name Responsible Worship through that?
Responsible Worship, like I said, that was birthed in Africa. Okay. I kind of don't know the name of the album yet because I'm still praying about that.
Yeah.
Okay. He's strategic. And I may be in the mall somewhere. And God said, that's the name. Okay. Open Heaven wasn't the name of the album.
I was about to say, I heard that recently.
That it wasn't the
it
name
of the album. It came to you as well.
It came to me. And I, this one, I just don't know what it is yet. And so I'm going to wait and hear the voice of the Lord concerning it. But whatever it is, it's going to be intentional. Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
After hearing this,
yeah,
the experience
Hallelujah.
That we're going to have in Toronto, March 2020.
Yes.
I'm looking forward to it.
So looking forward to it.
Hallelujah.
Man,
yeah.
Praise
if
God.
There was anything that you would say to a young worship leader that is aiming to come to this responsible worship clinic, if there was something you could pour into their lives, I'm going to give you the time to just say what you would say to them.
I would say the expectation is to be open. To be open, because the kinds of things that happen at Responsible Worship is not your typical thing. We actually believe in miracles, signs, and wonders, and we have seen them manifest. I would say come expecting to see that. Expect God to, it's miracle-based, actually. It's really what it is. We know lives will be changed, but it's just a different... I just feel something different for 2020. And it's really... It's a cliche, but I just really... You know, the cliche is 2020 vision and, you know, all, no, but I really believe that people will leave knowing their full purpose. Their full purpose. Not just the responsibility piece, but it will thrust them into their next. I just believe that whatever scales are on your eyes will fall off. That Damascus experience, you will literally see what God wants you to do. He's going to be even strategic then. And so it wouldn't surprise me if revival starts breaking out in different regions after responsible worship, literally, because there are people that are serving right now who are dead inside. And I just believe that revival will happen. And I believe that people will leave there with a fire in them and go back to wherever they are to ignite. That's what I believe.
Man,
hallelujah.
This has been such a powerful time with Maranda Curtis. She is such a humble and real soul. And it was our pleasure having you here to talk to you today.
Man. We're done?
Yeah, well, no. I had a question, but you
actually
answered it, because I always wondered, how does gospel artists pick a city or town or country in order to do a live recording? Because you always hear, Ty Tribbett in San Diego, let's say, or in London, we know that the artists are not necessarily from there. So how do you guys pick the so-called place to do a live recording?
I just thought it would be great, since I was already there for the clinic. Since I'll already be there for the clinic, okay. I said, okay, God was like, do the recording. Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Mm-hmm. But the reason I picked Toronto was because of the hunger I saw. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was beyond, they know me here. No, it was the hunger that I saw. I said, they're hungry. I want to go back there. And so I chose it based upon the hunger that I saw.
Mm-hmm. The genuine hunger for worship.
Genuine hunger for
Let's go.
For worship. Yeah.
And we've seen that. That's the wave in Canada now. Like,
there's a deep passion.
Oh. Hallelujah. Passion. And I saw that over the people when I was there. And it just, and I fell in love so much so. I said, I don't know when I'm coming back, but I'm coming back. Wow. Because it was one of the greatest experiences that I've ever experienced in my life. How we were all, like, the glory of the Lord was so evident in the room. Mm. And I said, I want to not duplicate it, but I have to come back and just be amongst these amazing people and worship with them. It was beautiful. So the hunger for worship is why I came back.
Oh, man. I just can't wait.
Yeah.
If you're listening right now, once again, we have Maranda Curtis here with Powerhouse Radio. We're talking responsible worship. Guys, there's nothing else that we can say other than you need to make sure that you are there. This is March 2020. Get your registration done on imaranda.com. I am Maranda.com.
Make sure you get your VIP ticket for the clinic. It's going to be awesome. Mm-hmm. And with that VIP ticket, you'll get free admission to the live recording.
Yes, that's
right. And if you can't make it to the clinic, you can still come to the live recording with $25 admission. Let's sell this place out, people. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Wow. We're so humbled.
Wow.
And we are so glad and honored that you've accepted our invitation, that you came here, and we don't even know what to say right
now. This is the part where you say, and we ain't got nothing else to say.
Yeah, every week we always say, until then, we ain't got nothing else to say.
All right, so we're going to get back to the music. Thank you guys all for tuning in. Thank you, Maranda.
Thank you.
Let's get back to the music. This is on Powerhouse Radio.
Let's go.
G98.7 FM Studios, Maranda Curtis. Welcome, Maranda, to the studios. Let me welcome you to Gospel Morning.
It
is an honor to have you here.
I'm very excited to be here.
Yes.
First time.
Yes.
First time. Yes.
You have such warmth, grace. You walked in the hug, and you just related in 10 seconds. You related. We'll talk about that.
Yes.
And I would always, when I welcome, I always say something on behalf of our president and founder. I will still say that on behalf of our president and founder, because he founded this platform for this very reason. And that's why even what we're walking through, he knew you were going to be here today. We produced. He knew the show.
Wow.
It had to happen.
Yes.
And I want to thank you, because so many times it's, artists are coming, they get up, it's tired, but you're here. How do you get to look so fresh and like it looked like it's in the afternoon, you know, bright early morning, you know, 8 a.m.
Indeed.
The grace of the Lord is all over you.
Wow.
Thank you.
Glory to God.
I'm going to ask you, Maranda, just, you know, to talk, you know, share your testimony, share about you, because I'm going to, for the first time, I'm going to work my artist, the guest in the house, because
wow.
you're going to take me through this morning, wondering how I'm going to take you through.
Wow.
So I'm giving you the platform.
Wow.
To share.
Let me just say that is a humbling experience right now for me to be here to see you, to speak to you, and to be welcomed to Canada, to Toronto, first time being here. And I don't take these moments lightly because, you know, God has opened so many doors, and I find myself in a place of gratefulness.
Yes.
To be able to be invited to such an amazing place because of the things that God has done. So I echo the song, "To God Be the Glory,"
yes.
For the things that He's done. I'm looking forward to what God is getting ready to do tonight through His people. I think we're living in a time where God is speaking. God is speaking, and I believe that we're in a time where we sing about miracles, signs, and wonders, but, you know, I believe that we're in a time where we'll definitely see the manifestation of those things. I grew up in a large family. I have four sisters and two brothers.
You had the fun family.
The fun family, the noisy family.
Wow.
I grew up in a big family, seven children.
Yes.
I'm the fourth of seven, the middle child.
Wow, the middle child. So you're supposed to have issues.
I'm supposed to have them.
Yes.
And so parents, musical. My dad is a singer. My mom passed away over a month ago. She was a singer.
Condolences to you.
Thank you so much. And so musical family. So I grew up in a house of music, full of music.
Yes.
However, we didn't go to church.
Wow. Really?
Really? My parents grew up in church, but didn't take us to church. Just living a life of rebellion and didn't take us. But I bless God for our move from Miami, Florida to Georgia. And that was when the life of church began for myself and the rest of my family. And I was thrown in the choir. My mom said, "You sing, so you got to get in the choir."
Yes, yes.
Those kinds of things. Yes. And I was directing choirs for years and realized by the time that I was 20 years old, I was singing to a God that I didn't have a relationship with.
Wow. Wow.
So I was singing all of these years. Yeah. Just out of obedience to my parents.
Wow.
I didn't give my heart to the Lord until I was 20 years old.
Wow. So you weren't at the highest level yet, because I can imagine what's about to happen when you've met with Him.
Exactly.
You know, experienced
and
Him.
Exactly. And so at 20, my life changed. Yeah. I gave my heart to the Lord. I got saved. And I started leading worship at the age of 20. I'll be 40 in August. So 20 years in it.
Yes.
And I was just thrown in it because you can sing, so you're supposed to lead worship. I knew nothing. I was a babe in Christ.
Wow.
I didn't know about exhorting and the scriptures, and I'm still studying to try to be my best self.
Yes.
And so through trial and error, I became a worship leader. And about 4 years later, I got the attention of Pastor John P. Key.
Yes.
And it was through his Victory and Praise Conference.
Yeah.
He recognized me. And years later, he said, "I want you to be my worship leader."
I said,
okay. Yes. I'm just serving my church, but okay. So I packed up and I moved to Charlotte, became his worship leader, and traveled with him. And that was the turn of me as a worshiper.
Yeah.
Because until then, I was only doing what I knew to do.
Yeah.
And it took him to say, "Hey, come here, let me speak to you."
Yeah.
When you worship,
I need you to duck and let the people see God.
Mm.
And so what that meant was humility has to be a part of what you do.
That
there's no vain glory here.
Yes.
That God has to get the glory. And again, I quote my tribute, just let me live my life and let it be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And should I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. So he was basically telling me, when you're up there, you're an instrument, but you're a guide to God.
Yes.
That moment is not about you. So that was the turn of my approach to God. My approach in worship. That it is Jesus centered. And through our obedience in worship, we reap. That's fruit. There's a scripture that says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. There's some things that we just don't do because we sometimes we worship from a place of need and we don't acknowledge God first. My assignment in the earth is to point back to God. And through that, the blessings will come. The miracles will come. The signs will come. So just making the Lord priority in our lives. To me, the ultimate worship is our lives.
That is, you know, that is is powerful. And, you know, especially when you say, you know, you just went through the motion, so to speak, at first. Just was just basically living what you learned going through, you know. But when you've experienced him, and I think you can understand, I love what you're saying, growing up a PK myself, you know, the choir preacher's kid, and going to church, there comes a time you have to meet with the Lord and understand him, you know, for yourself. You experience him. You know, it's not just mommy praying for you, and whatever. You don't know how to pray because you understand the source. You know? I know your music has just touched so many lives, I can tell you. It has, it takes you to a realm to understand that God is limitless. But that's how we interpret it. That's how we relate to it. I want to ask you, you know, what's your inspiration behind the song Open Heaven, the album? Tell us about that.
Oh my goodness. The song Open Heaven was birthed while I was preparing for intercessory prayer. I was getting ready and the melody came to me and then the words came to me. And typically when that happens, I'm like, oh, okay. But I took my phone out. I said, because I had a feeling that I shouldn't forget this one. I took my phone and recorded it in my phone. And I was thinking that it was something that the Lord may, possibly wanted me to sing that night during intercessory prayer. But he said, no, save it. Months later, I was preparing to do a live recording. And that live recording was just supposed to be an add-on to songs I already had recorded. Because I needed more songs. Only to discover, I didn't even know the name of the album until after the recording. Open Heaven almost didn't get recorded because I forgot. And the Lord sent it back to my remembrance. And I sent it to my producer and I said, okay, this is a cappella. But this is what I hear. I hear wind. I hear trees. I hear birds. I hear this sound. And he was able to capture
that.
He was able to capture that. And we recorded it. And it wasn't until like a month after I was like, Open Heaven, this is the name of the album. This is the name of the album. So through prayer, preparing for prayer, God downloaded that in my spirit. And I'm so glad that I was in the right place to hear. And grab it.
Yeah. If you're just joining, you're listening to Maranda Curtis, that's live in the studios of G987 FM right now. Maranda, if you could share, if you could share a testimony, what would that testimony be?
Oh my. God healed me from diabetes, from type 2 diabetes. I didn't know what was happening with me. All of a sudden I got sick and I just started losing weight. Stubborn, wouldn't go to the doctor. And then finally, 2016, it was the day after Christmas.
I laid there in my bed and I said, I feel like I'm dying. Mm. And I didn't loosely say that. It really felt like life was leaving me.
Yeah.
Got up and went to the emergency room, to the hospital. And I said, I think I have the flu, because I had symptoms of the flu.
Yeah.
And they tested me, ran tests, and they said, no, you don't have the flu. We're going to take some blood and run some tests. Yeah. Got back. The doctor said, you have type 2 diabetes. And he said, do you know what your blood glucose is? I said, no. He said, 750.
What?
I said, I don't know what that means.
I was just about to say, tell our listeners what that number means. I know what that means. Tell our listeners.
That means that had I stayed home, I would have slipped into a diabetic coma.
You want to tell them what your numbers are supposed to be?
Oh, my goodness. Let's start there. 70.
Oh, Lord.
We're going to start at 70 to about 99-ish.
And you were at?
I was at 750.
Is that like 100-fold right there?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And.
Wow.
And
so you were walking dead.
I was walking. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
And so they ended up admitting me into the hospital, kept me for like 4 or 5 days. And I made a decision. One, because faith without works is dead.
Yeah. Yes.
And diabetes is something. Well, type 2 diabetes is something that I felt that I could control because of decisions.
Yes.
And so I laid up in that hospital, asked every question that I could. Now, what foods am I supposed to eat? Now, what am I supposed to stay away from? And I left that hospital with a different mindset. Before they released me, they gave me 2 insulins. No pills.
Wow.
2 needles. 1 to take 3 times a day and 1 to take at the end of the day.
Mm.
And I said to God, I'm going to give myself a year to get off of this medicine because I had to undo bad habits.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
And I worked on it and worked on it and worked on it. And let me just say that I got off of insulin in less than a year.
Wow. And what year was this?
This was 2017.
And you're still off.
I'm still off to this day.
Well, glory
so
be to God.
I said, I have to maintain that testimony. And so.
Jesus, if you heard her pause, she's hearing her song. That's the thank you.
That's the thank you medley. Yes. And that's actually the song. There's a part 2 to that. That I actually shared this testimony.
Oh, yeah, because this is part 1, yes.
And I'm just grateful to God that I had a mind to want to change.
Yes.
And I said, God, if you heal me, I'll maintain it.
Wow. Yes. Yeah.
I'll maintain it. Yes. I said, I'm too young.
Yes.
To be dying from this. I'm too young to be leaving here. So I thank God for a different mindset.
Yeah.
So God is a healer.
God definitely is a healer. Talk to our listeners a little bit there, Dev, and tell them.
And first of all, we just want to thank Toronto again for an amazing support for this event. G98, you know, we can't say thank you more. Mm. It is family. Mr. G, he would have been sitting right now hugging Maranda, and we know that is exactly what he would have been, and the smiles and everything.
Yes.
And you know, we're not in sorrow, we are celebrating, and our family, Gospel Connection family, you know, we want to celebrate Mr. G with the whole of Toronto tonight, and we're taking a moment tonight.
Yes.
A good moment to celebrate the gift that God gave us, which is Him. And God gave us Him for the perfect time, because He was able to create this platform.
Yes.
And obviously, we can go back to Major's and all of that.
Major Awards.
Major Awards.
Major Awards. It's hard for the artists.
You remember when I used to sing?
Remember you used to sing it? You got nominated.
We got nominated. Yeah, yeah. The group. And
yeah, to be reckoned with. Arville right there. Those are sound antics, all that, you know. Yes. So and it goes with all the artists, a lot of the artists' names, DJ Nicholas.